Hi, Jernej.
Hey, Liz, how are you?
Thank you. You've just hosted our annual European Financials Conference. Give us a sense of what it was like this year.
This is our 24th annual European Financials Conference. So in its 24th year, this is one of the longest running events that we organize in Europe, but also at the firm. So despite the fact that the conference was done virtually, I mean, we were extremely pleased to be able, that we were able to draw on executive managements of basically all major European banks, European insurance companies, diversified financial companies, and real estate companies. As every year, a large portion of our conference is dedicated to conversations with the various policymakers, regulators, and supervisors. In Europe, in particular, that still remains very important because a large portion of the overall investment proposition is essentially dependent on the decisions of the policymakers, the landscape of the European financial system as a whole, and the path that they're plotting for Europe also, as you can imagine, are extremely important topics.
So what was the sentiment like among participants?
So I think it really splits into three categories. On the one side, you had the sentiment of the presenting companies, so executive managements of these financial companies. On the other side, you had the policymakers and the regulators, and then you had the investors. I mean, as you can imagine, the dominant theme that trumps everything else is this public health crisis that we're currently going through. I think in general, the assessment was that we are in a period which is going to be very harsh, very sharp economic contraction. And I think here there's consensus among all three groups. I think everybody agrees that near term, there's a lot more pain to come. But then opinions start to differ. So I think the policymakers put forward a more optimistic picture for 2021 and 22. I think a number of bank and insurance presenters try to be optimistic as well. But as you can imagine, I think when it comes to investors, so people that commit capital to these institutions, their expectations about the recovery in 21 and 22 are certainly a cut below what you had from policymakers and banks.
So in research that you published before the conference, you identified some key themes that will impact European banks going forward. Can you tell us about those?
So, I mean, in general, when we look at the sector today, we think about three things. So the overriding theme is how bad this is going to get on the macro side and what is the translation into the bank's balance sheets and the P&L. So the credit quality theme is number one. Will investors be allowed to be paid dividends in what is obviously a very highly politicized environment, an environment in which solutions are currently found on the public sector side of the equation, not in the private sector? So solvency, kind of the next topic. And the third one is liquidity. And I think our expectation was that the debate is going to coalesce around these three themes. In reality, it was the first two that dominated, essentially, which is credit quality and solvency and ability of banks to distribute dividends. I think on credit quality, you have two questions to which there are no clear answers. And to me, one of the really interesting things was that it seemed that the information advantage that usually managements have when it comes to communicating on credit quality vis-a-vis investors currently is just not there. So I think everybody is to some extent guessing. And these two questions are, how high do credit losses go and for how long do they stay elevated? But you see, we still don't know for how long these lockdowns are going to last, which has the direct translation into how bad it gets on credit quality deterioration. We still do not know what the probability of a second wave of this public health crisis is. And thirdly, in Europe, which for us is very relevant, we still don't know the outcome of Brexit. And I think this to me was also one of the key takeaways, that last year's conference was dominated by Brexit. This year, we're 2 weeks away from the extension, from the deadline for extension, and six months away from the end of the transition period. There is this additional potential shock to the financial system that's looming, and yet it doesn't even feature. So this was the stuff on credit quality. I don't think we got any concrete answers, but we certainly did gain incremental insight. Overall, the communication from bank management was quite constructive, but again, I don't think there is information edge there when it comes to predicting the outcome of these three things.
And what about solvency?
I think so. Solvency is an all-encompassing issue, right? So there's the static component, which is, does a bank have enough capital today? There's the dynamic component, which is it sufficiently profitable to generate capital as time goes on, and therefore is it able to pay a dividend? So I think on the first component, on the static component, there's a lot of reassurance, both from banks and policymakers, and I think they're both right. We think they're both right. I think that the capital position of banks today in Europe is actually quite reasonable. But two issues came up on the dynamic side of the equation. The one that we didn't necessarily anticipate to come up out this strongly was a point made by a number of managers and policymakers. And essentially it goes along the lines of banks had sufficient capital to sustain the initial shock of the crisis, but there's doubts that they have sufficient capital to underwrite the recovery phase of the crisis. And this, I think, is a very important point to which we haven't paid enough attention, I think. And then the second question becomes, are you able to pay a dividend? Are you sufficiently solvent and profitable to pay a dividend? This question has a regulatory component to it. It has a political component to it as well. But ultimately, it's a really problematic question for the regulators as well. Why? So dividends for European banks were suspended in March, and as a consequence, the share prices fell. But if the starting assumption is banks might not have enough capital to underwrite the recovery phase of the crisis, then the follow-on question is, well, who's going to provide that capital to them? And there can be only one answer. That capital can come from the market, and the market will not commit capital to banks unless there is a reward for that investment, and that reward can only be a dividend. So I think a disproportionate amount of time was spent discussing the capacity of banks to underwrite recovery and to remunerate shareholders.
And what about liquidity? You've written that it's unlikely to be an issue given policymaker intervention.
I think you're right. I think, look, so our expectation was that there's going to be more time spent discussing liquidity, and maybe that's our historic reflex, because in 2008, at the time of global financial crisis, and also in 2012, when we had the sovereign crisis here in Europe, liquidity was the central topic. But essentially, the message on liquidity is we've learned our lessons at the previous iterations of the crisis, and the policy support is so ample that I think the question almost went the other way. All right, so liquidity positions are great, they've been boosted. What do we do with all the funds that are now sitting on our balance sheet? There isn't consensus on many things between the executive management, regulators, and investors, but there is consensus on the fact that this crisis will be worse in any historic context, that it will be worse than 2008 and 9, and that, of course, it will be worse than the 2012 sovereign crisis was in Europe. And I think the data that's coming through supports that. And I think the extent of the policy response also supports that view. If policymakers weren't extremely concerned about what is around the corner, I don't think we would have gotten that policy response. And that includes all of the support mechanisms which were put in place for the financial system. So I think that there's agreement on that. Now, how long it lasts, whether it's going to be longer or shorter than the financial crisis and the sovereign crisis, that we don't know yet. And I think a lot still depends on those two factors that I outlined before. How long does the lockdown last, and is there a second wave?
Thanks, Jernej.
Thank you very much.